All right, welcome back to Night Nurse, everybody. Lovers of learning are here for more Night Nurse. So here we go. We're going to talk about microbiology and infection today. So first, what is involved in microbiology and infection? What makes a good pathogen? Different types of microbiology like bacteria, viruses, fungi, different parasites. We'll talk about host resistance to infection and the transmission of infection. And we'll get into the stages of infection and different diagnostic testing, like left and right shifts that we see in a CBC with differential. And we'll talk about nosocomial infections. So what is microbiology? Microbiology is the study of microorganisms. So those could include the bacteria, viruses, fungi, molds, protozoa. Now, microorganisms can be pathogenic. That's why we study disease. Pathogenic means they cause diseases. Examples of this are like Streptococcus, influenza, SARS, and malaria. But organisms can also be non-pathogenic, where they typically do not cause any disease, and many of them can be beneficial, like Lactobacillus, which is in the gut and in our secretions and actually helps protect us from more invasive species from getting a hold on us. Now, we have this gray area of opportunistic infections where we have opportunistic pathogens. These organisms are usually non-pathogenic organisms, often found on us, and they become pathogenic if given a chance. They kind of take advantage of a situation. Examples of this are like Candida yeast, where we have immunodeficiency or frequent antibiotic use, can disrupt the normal flora and give them a competitive advantage to overgrow and cause an overwhelming infection. Also, Clostridium difficile, this is an organism that causes infectious diarrhea and actually can become quite severe, especially in those who are at risk for developing dehydration. So what makes a good pathogen? Well, pathogenesis is the microbe's ability to cause disease. And another way of putting this is virulence. So virulence is the degree of an organism's pathogenicity or ability to cause disease. And certain factors come into play. One being communicability, the ability to spread to a host. Also infectivity, once it's able to find a host, how good is the organism at invading tissues and beginning to multiply to cause infection. Invasive quality is how infectious is the organism. If once encountering a host, how often is it successful at causing an infection? We also have toxigenicity, the ability to produce harmful toxins. We've talked about exotoxins coming from gram-positive bacteria. They often cause illness during the bacterial healthy life cycle. And then we have the endotoxins from often found in gram-negative bacteria, and these endotoxins can cause illness after the bacteria dies and they're released from the cell wall. We also have to remember that the pathogen can avoid host defenses. So how do they do that? They can do it through structures like sex pili, plasmid, slime, capsules. We'll talk about some of those. They can also use strategies like viral antigenic variation. So remember that when we talked about specific immunity and immunoglobulins, they're creating antibodies for a specific protein, usually the surface protein. And if the virus changes the antigen, the look of the protein, sometimes that can avoid host defense. It does this through antigenic drift, where it has mild changes, where often the organism will still have some recognition of the organism. So mild changes tend to cause less of a concern, but then also antigenic shift, where there's a major change in the protein structure and the host body doesn't recognize it at all. Examples of this can be influenza H5N1, H1N1, and the coronavirus, where we saw major changes, so we were all pretty much naive to these. So let's talk about these different organisms. So we have bacteria. Bacteria are prokaryotic, which pro means before, kary means a body. So bacteria are prokaryotic. They do not have a nucleus. They're unicellular. They do not require a host to live. They can live pretty much wherever they want. They often do live as our normal flora, but they can become pathogenic. Examples of this are Staphylococcus aureus or Staph A. They do contain a cell wall. The cell wall has varied amounts of a protein called peptidoglycan. Peptidoglycan is actually what's often used for antibiotics to target this. If there's a thick peptidoglycan layer, it's gram-positive. So what's the gram stain? In review, gram stain uses cell wall composition and peptidoglycan. A gram-positive bacteria, when stained, the thick peptidoglycan layer takes up a lot of this purple-violet stain, and so we get gram-positive, and gram-positive organisms often have exotoxins. So gram-positive antibiotics can attack this peptidoglycan layer, destroy, disrupt the cell wall of the organism, and that's how it wipes out, that's how antibiotics wipe out bacteria. Now, a gram-negative bacteria is gram-negative because it doesn't take up the stain. Because it doesn't have the thick peptidoglycan layer. So gram-positive antibiotics aren't as effective against gram-negative bacteria. So this is why a gram stain is often done with organisms as usually a first-line move. In addition to the gram stain recognition, bacteria can be classified by their size and their shape. So cocci are round. They can be doubled up, diplococci. They can run in strips. Kind of like you see in the slide there where you can see these long strips, that'd be a streptococci. If they're bundled up like grapes, that's staphylococci. Staphyl means like grapes. And then bacilli are gram-negative rods. The most dangerous gram-negative rod we usually encounter is E. coli or Escherichia coli. So bacteria have ways to avoid our host defense so they can cause disease. The first of these being that rigid cell wall that gives them shape and protection. They can also have capsules and slime layers that help protect against our immunoglobulins, our humoral defenses, from recognizing the foreign antigens. They can have cilia, which are small hair-like paddle structures that allow them to escape. They can have fimbri, which are small hair-like structures that instead of escaping, actually act like Velcro and allow them to cling on to our tissues, even though mucus and different host defenses might be trying to slough them away, they can cling on like Velcro. They can also create sex pili, where one bacterium transfers DNA, RNA directly to another bacteria. Maybe they've developed some sort of advantage, some sort of cheater, like, for example, making beta-lactamase, which we'll talk about, which is an enzyme that breaks down bacteria. One bacteria can conjugate or join with another with a sex pilus and share their naked protein directly so that the new organism can now has that cheater material to be able to have a competitive advantage against the host. Also, bacteria can make toxins. We've talked about that. Exotoxins, gram-positive. They typically secrete exotoxins when they're alive and healthy. Examples would be Streptococcus pyogenes, which causes quite a fever. Endotoxins from gram-negative bacteria that are embedded within the cell wall and they're released upon the death of the bacteria. Examples of this would be certain strains of E. coli, and they can often cause sepsis. It often gets worse the first 12 to 24 hours after antibiotic treatment is initiated. So they have this rough patch after being treated where the patient can actually get worse, and then once they get through that rough patch, then they begin to improve. One really bad toxin is called lipid A toxin. It's a lipopolysaccharide that activates complement, makes all of our vessels leaky, that causes edema, lowers our blood pressure, that can lead to tissue ischemia. Also, it activates clotting cascades with activating a platelet activating factor or platelet aggregating factor, PAF. And that can cause inappropriate clots and bleeding to develop in something called disseminated intravascular coagulopathy, or DIC. So ugly news, okay? So toxins can be ugly news. Bacteria can also make certain enzymes like beta-lactamase. Beta-lactam antibiotics have a beta-lactam ring that binds to the peptidoglycan layer of the bacteria and breaks it up and destroys the bacteria and kills it. Big beta-lactam antibiotics are penicillin and cephalosporins. So if the organism has the ability to break down the antibiotics through beta-lactamase, then this renders these antibiotics ineffective against the bacteria. So whenever you see ASE, ACE, on a word, that means it's an enzyme that breaks down whatever came first. So beta-lactam ACE breaks down beta-lactam antibiotics. That's an easy way to remember what an enzyme does. Bacteria can also multiply, and they can multiply asexually through binary fission. So the cell just divides and creates two identical daughter cells, so they can thrive even when their numbers are low. Bacteria identification often occurs through culture and sensitivity. So we culture something, we find an organism, we open up a wound or something, and we send that off to lab, and lab cultures that, exposing it to different types of tests for identification. If an organism is identified, then it's put on often a plate to determine its sensitivity. So what you see on this slide is the film is the bacteria growing, and then the little black discs are discs of different types of antibiotics. So the halos that you see are actually showing that the filmy and the filming bacteria didn't come anywhere near that disc. And that gives us the zone of inhibition in millimeters and tells us how much that bacteria truly, truly hates that different antibiotic. In other words, it's sensitive. So what you see here is the one on the far left there has quite a large halo, which that would be a very good antibiotic to use because it has a large zone of inhibition, and that bacteria did not want to get anywhere near that antibiotic because it kills it. So that's a very good bacteria. The one there in the middle with the arrow on it, you can see it's kind of the halo's kind of hazy, and it's not nearly as big, probably less than half. So that organism, or that antibiotic wouldn't be as good because the organism is more tolerant. It's resistant to it. So often you'll see on your lab report for culture and sensitivity, you'll see that the organism is either sensitive, in other words, it dies when exposed to the antibiotic, that's what we want, or it's resistant, or it's indeterminate. It wasn't that good, but it wasn't terrible. And we use that to guide treatment. Now, viruses, they are small obligate intracellular parasites that require a living host for replication. So they can be extracellular, and they're called a viron, but they need us to multiply. They consist of a protein coat or a capsid, a core of DNA or RNA, and an outer protective envelope that acts as a cloak of invisibility to try to avoid detection from the humoral and cell-mediated immunities. They have a site of variability. This is typically the surface antigen, and that's what can change through antigenic drift or antigenic shift to cause worsening symptoms. When we think of viruses, we typically think of a retrovirus, and a retrovirus kind of works backwards into using the cells factory to make more viruses. So it tricks the cell. And the way it does it is a virus attaches to the host cell, and then the virus injects its RNA or DNA and infuses it into the host cell DNA. This is the latent stage of the virus. The virus is growing quite slowly, and this patient may actually be asymptomatic. This is a good time for antivirals to kick in because antivirals, which typically end in VIR, they slow replication and do not directly kill the virus, but slow the replication, which is key. The viral DNA RNA will actually use the host cell manufacturing process to produce more viral proteins and more viruses. Now, if the infected cell shows a foreign surface antigen that it's already infected, this is when T cells and cell-mediated immunity may recognize that the cell is infected and would kill it through apoptosis. If that does not happen, the new viruses that have been made within the cell are released by the cell bursting, or the cells just, the virus is just kind of leaving through a budding process. They're released out into the world to then go out into the bloodstream and search for new uninfected cells to infect. And that is the cycle of the virus. So pretty nasty. Now, fungi, mycotic diseases, they're single-celled yeast or molds. They're eukaryotic, so they contain a nucleus. They do not contain any peptidoglycan, so typical antibiotics are ineffective. And the growth is promoted by dark and damp areas, which can often be found on the body. they're often beneficial. They're often normal flora that protect against more invasive pathogens getting a foothold. However, they can be harmful when they become opportunistic. So such things as tinea, you know, athlete's foot, the dermatophytes, or yeast, the candidas, can be opportunistic. This usually occurs when we have some sort of disruption in the microbiome. Maybe you're given a very strong antibiotic for a sinus infection. Well, that's going to kill a lot of our good microbiome organisms and allow these yeast that are not susceptible to the antibiotics to thrive. They can also thrive when a patient has some sort of immunodeficiency, some sort of dysfunction. They reproduce through budding or hyphae. This is where long strands of fungi just kind of stretch out like a branch being grown on a tree. And they can also produce spores, which are really pretty nasty because these break off, go into soil, go wherever they want, and they can be very, very tolerant of poor climates and just wait their turn. And then someone goes out and digs in the soil, they get these spores, they inhale them, now they're in a nice warm area in the respiratory tract, and the spores become activated and actually cause disease. So they can often cause lung disease. This is why if you're cleaning up old dusty barns or bird poop or rat poop or something like that, then you always want to wear a mask because there can be spores in the dirt. Parasitic diseases are our protozoa and friends. They're eukaryotic, so they contain a nucleus. They do not contain a cell wall. Irregular, changing shapes. The typical antibiotics will not be effective because they have no peptidoglycan layer, so they're treated with atypical antimicrobials. They're mobile. They usually have a flagella or multiple cilia to move. Some live on dead material. Many don't require a host at all. And they can become pathogenic when they come and join us. Examples of that are transmission through a vector, like malaria. The plasmodium reproduces and matures within our red blood cells when it's delivered by the vector of a mosquito. Another way is transmission through contaminated water that contains feces, like Entamoeba histolytica, and this causes tissue destruction and bloody diarrhea, so dehydration is a severe risk. Also, we could have the parasitic worms, like the helminths, like the hookworm, which grabs on for dear life and sucks blood from the host, and that's how it gets its nutrients as a parasite. Now, we talked about the ability for the host to resist invaders through nonspecific inflammation and the specific immunity of the B's and T lymphocytes, but we also have some chemokines, namely interferons and interleukins. Interferons stimulate the immune response against foreign invaders, specifically viruses. So you can think of interferons as interfering with viral replication. Interleukins, there's tons of them. They're cytokines that activate and allow intercommunication among immune players. Two biggies are IL-1 and IL-6. They large players in the activation of neutrophils and macrophages to stir up the immune system. Many of these are produced by the T helper cell, the CD4, but other cells can produce them as well. Factors that affect host resistance to infection include the age of the host, the genetic predisposition, if they have some sort of immunodeficiency, maybe they're malnourished, so low protein means low immunoglobulins that can reduce humoral specific immunity. Chronic diseases and comorbidities kind of wear on the body and kind of have the body attacking multiple fronts, and that reduces host resistance. Any type of stress, physical or emotional, causes the release of corticosteroids. The big corticosteroid that we have in our body is called cortisol, and it reduces inflammation and reduces immune response. Inflammation, trauma, poor inflammatory response, and remember that any type of reduced host defense that is caused by us, steroids or anti-inflammatories, that's an iatrogenic cause. It's caused by actually some sort of treatment we have. So if you have a reduction and you actually have transmission of infection, that is a problem. So the nice thing about it is if we break any step in the transmission cycle, we prevent an infection. So we have a microorganism. We have an agent. It is in some sort of source, some sort of reservoir. Patient's hands, inside the patient, linens, vectors, and so that organism has to get out of the source, has to exit the reservoir of the source somehow. and it needs to be transmitted to a susceptible host, either through a vector like a mosquito or a fly, or often through a non-living organism like, you know, fomite. So your stethoscope, your hands, these are transfers that can occur, and that's why we want to focus on the steps of infection. So if we have a transmission of a bug and we have a susceptible host, this is what leads to an infection, and that can lead to illness. So the stages of infection include different types of symptoms. Initially, the prodromal stage, there really are no symptoms. There's not very many organisms. They're growing, but they're not growing that fast, but they're starting to get their foothold. Then you'll see this huge linear increase where they have visible illness, both localized symptoms of pain, swelling, exudate, local tender lymph nodes, and then that can also lead to a non-specific systemic manifestations like the fever, fatigue, weakness, headache, nausea, all the things we talked about in immunity. If the infection is in the brain, they can have confusion and seizures, and this can go further and further, and it can lead to septicemia, and it can lead to death. Now, septicemia is an overwhelming infection where not only is the body fighting off infection, but it causes lots of inflammatory problems. So we get complement activated. That causes pro-inflammatory markers like tumor necrosis factor to be activated. This increases capillary permeability, causes system-wide vasodilation that leads to leaky vessels, edema, hypotension, and this all gets us to multiple tissue ischemia and hypoxia, which can lead to organ failure. We also, with the inflammation process, we activated platelet aggregating factor, or PAF, and this increases the clotting cascade and can lead to clotting disorders like DIC. Fortunately, in most cases, before it reaches septicemia, the immune system kicks in and we start to get a hold of the infection and the patient recovers. So that's good. Now, diagnostic tests of infection, we've already talked about the culture and sensitivity, but we have the CBC with differential. The CBC with diff monitors total white blood cell count initially. Total white blood cell count should be about 5 to 10,000. So 4,500 to 10,000 is considered normal. Any total white blood cell count above 10,000 or so starts to suggest infection. Then we can get a differential where we have these different types of white blood cells, the neutrophils, the lymphocytes, the basophils, the eosinophils, and we actually get a percentage distribution of the total white count. And there should be a predictable percentage distribution of these different types of white blood cells. So if we see an elevated neutrophil percentage, neutrophils are typically 50 to 70% of our white blood cells. But let's say we have 80% neutrophils, that's an elevated neutrophil percentage. And since neutrophils attack bacteria, that suggests a bacterial infection. That's called a left shift. On the contrary, we can have a right shift where we have elevated lymphocyte percentage, so elevated Bs and Ts. And since Bs and Ts attack viral or fungal infections, a right shift suggests a viral fungal infection in the patient. Different identifications of the organism. We talked about Gram staining, talked about culture and sensitivity. We can also do often quick testing of antibody testing, where if the organism is detected, then these tests will light up because we have an antibody attached to the strip. So if the antigen is detected in the sample, then it binds and turns color. So we get a line. So like in this instance, there's always one line that's a control. So it should always show positive because it's a control. And then if the other line shows up positive, then that shows rapid streps positive or influenza A, B, COVID, mono spot for mono, different types of tests. Pregnancy tests are often done this way. Lots of different tests can use antibodies. Now, nosocomial infection is an infection acquired in healthcare. So that's not good. So we can have pneumonias and urinary tract infections and hip fractures from falls. People can develop blood clots or DVTs, and they can get ulcers in their stomach. And these cost money. Interestingly enough, most insurance companies require you to treat these patients, but they will not reimburse for nosocomial infections. So the cost of that care, up and to including ICU care is on the facility because it was your fault. So what do we need to do to prevent this? Number one is hand washing. Always make sure you hand wash and also utilize universal precautions. If you're going to be handling something that might have secretions or blood, wear gloves. There are many protocols designed to prevent nosocomial infections too. So there are aspiration pneumonia protocols where the patient has to have the head of the bed elevated, they have to turn, cough, deep breathe, get out of bed if they can occasionally, try to get those lungs expanded to avoid a pneumonia. Also DVT prophylaxis, getting them up, moving them around, hydrating them, giving them heparin, and using compression devices on their legs to prevent development of blood clots. And then finally, ulcer prophylaxis. Patients that are ill can develop ulcers even if they have no history, so they're often given a proton pump inhibitor and they don't know why. Those end in prazol. So they're being given that. It's an ulcer prophylactic. So hopefully you found that helpful. That's infection. And if you enjoyed it, found it helpful, please subscribe to the Night Nurse Learning Channel. You can click on this link right here. You can also always find more content at nightnurse.com. I'm always adding new content to help you guys out. So thanks for joining us, and I appreciate you.